Hello everyone, thanks for coming to today's Daniel's Fund Faculty Fellows Program Faculty Workshop. It's my great honor today to introduce our speaker, Dr. Michael Loui, who is one of the most influential scholar, researcher in the field of engineering education and engineering ethics education probably in the world. I still remember... some of my colleagues in China still they're using Michael's video to teach engineering ethics, which is a good sign. Dr. Michael Loui is Dale and Susie Galligan Professor of Engineering Education at Purdue University. He was previously Professor of Electrical and Computer Engineering and University Distinguished Teacher Scholar at the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. He serves as editor of the Journal of Engineering Education, again, which is, I think, from my perspective, is the world's best journal in the field of engineering education. As a member of the editorial boards of College Teaching and Accountability in Research, and as a member of the Joint Advisory Group for the Online Ethics Center and National Academy of Engineering. In 2006, he was elected fellow of the IEEE for leadership in the teaching of engineering ethics. In 2003, he was named a Kenich Scholar by the Kenich Foundation for the Advance of Teaching. Professor Loui was Associate Dean of the Graduate College at Illinois from 1996 to 2000. He directed the Theory of Computing program at the National Science Foundation from 1990 to 1991. Dr. Loui earned his PhD at MIT in 1980. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Michael Loui.
Now you have to wear this.
Okay. Very good. Thank you all for coming on a beautiful sunny afternoon here in Golden. So we're going to show you how to succeed in teaching ethics without really trying. I took this title as a variation on the famous musical, How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying. And I'll show you how you can succeed, and you won't really have to try too much. So since 1993, as Amy asked me how long I've been doing this, so 24 years or so, I've been teaching ethics in several different formats. Full 3-credit, 1-semester course in engineering ethics and in professional ethics, different courses. 6 1-hour sessions in a summer undergraduate research program. 1 week in a sophomore course in digital systems and computer design. And 1 or 2 hours in a technical course in a research seminar. And as I was tell people, the students, you're going to spend about 1,600 hours in the classroom over your 4 or 5 years as an undergraduate in engineering, but this is the most important 1 or 2 hours of your entire life because, really, because you spend your entire lives being professionals. And you may never solve statics or circuits problems again, but you'll spend your entire lives being professionals. What I want to know, I'm going to break into small groups, and you get to move only once, so you have to move only once. I'm going to use playing cards to do this. So I'd like you to introduce just your name and your department or program you're in, and what kind of format you're thinking of teaching ethics in. So you are?
Oh, I'm Lauren, and I'm in ethics and humanitarian engineering. And I envision teaching this in the future in a semester-long course. A whole course that deals with engineering and the grand challenges.
Excellent. Okay. Lauren?
I'm Melanie. So. I'm in the Haas department, which is the renamed OAIS for those of you uninitiated. And I teach ethics in the NHV course, as well as the combo course that Lauren referenced that is an ethics course in the Engineering Grand Challenges.
Very good. Myrna, right?
Yeah, thank you.
I'm Myrna. I'm with a first year engineering here. I guess we're called Design at Minds, Cornerstone of Design at Minds now. And I'm also part of the Thorson Honors first year program, which is a combination of NHV and ethics first year. And then I guess the way of which we've done it in ethics before, we don't do that anymore. So, but I look forward to what we're going to do in the honors version, NHV and ethics.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Myrna. So about a couple of class sessions or something. So Amy.
I'm Amy Kuzik, and I work at the Mines Foundation helping to raise funds for the university. And I work with the Daniels Fund as one of my partnerships that I work with.
So you pretend that you're going to do this.
I'm going to pretend.
No, it's good because this will get you engaged. And you're Bo, right?
I am. Hi, Bo Coretto with the Daniels Fund, and I manage all of our ethics funds.
Okay, very good. Oh, John, right?
John Leibniz and Haas, and I'm going to use the materials from today's workshop in two 400 level courses, one intercultural communication and the other one called scientific controversies.
Okay, so sort of class modules, one or two or several class sessions, something like that, John. Good. Cindy, right?
Yes. Cindy Ritter with Computer Science. I'm going to teach this in our summer 6-week course, and it's probably closest to the 1 or 2 hours. It's probably in between those. We're just going to try to sneak in some ethics while they're doing work for clients.
Okay, very good. Mirtu.
Hi, I'm a master's student in Mining Engineering Department. I would like to get into the academic line in future. Probably I'm teaching in 10 years or so.
Okay.
But I look if ethics can be integrated in every of our classes, like at the end of the session, mm-hmm. end of the academic session, you could have one class specifically.
Okay. You're going to put it at the end of the semester where it's marginalized and students will forget. Okay. Okay. But better than nothing. Your name?
Loui. Here. I'm in geophysics. I have been teaching ethics as a one credit semester long class, mm-hmm. And I don't quite know how that's going to evolve in the future.
Okay, very good. Semester long class, yes. Your name is?
Chuan Yue.
Yeah.
Chuan in the computer science department.
Oh, okay.
Assistant professor. So I'm one of the Daniel's fellows.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to integrate ethics instruction into my security and cryptography.
Okay,
courses.
Security and cryptography. So several sessions in security and cryptography. That's a very natural place to put it. Yes.
Hi, I'm Tony Lefton.
Tony?
I'm in Haas, and I'm also a Daniels Fellow, working with Sarah to integrate as seamlessly as possible ethics in our first year honors program,
mm-hmm.
Integrating it into almost every single lesson plan.
Ooh,
we have.
That's good.
I'm also one of the Ethics Bowl coaches working with Sandy Woodson.
Okay.
So, and I also try to integrate ethics into all of my classes, including my creative writing course.
Wow, very good. So again, your name is?
Tony.
Tony, yes. And you
and
are?
I'm the Sarah.
The Sarah.
I won't repeat any of that.
Good.
Yes.
But you work together.
Yes.
Very good. Very good, Sarah.
On the same things.
Okay. You are?
I am Christy Savina.
Krista? Yes.
Mechanical engineering. Jared and I, so I'll play their role, are looking at expanding how we teach ethics currently in Capstone. And then also I'm involved with the ME curriculum, so looking at threading ethics better throughout.
Excellent. Yeah, several places, yeah. And you're?
What she said. I'm Jared.
You're Jared. Okay. Very good. Jared, and you are?
I'm George. I'm
George.
An interloper. I'm not going to take a card because I can only be here for a few minutes. I just happened to be on campus doing a guest lecture in a course on water politics and policy. I heard first about the Daniels Fund because I go one day a week up to CSU and you're linked to the business school. And when I learned that you were also active on this campus and this was happening, I thought I better find out a little bit
Should
about
come.
What's going on.
Yeah, so get a handout at least since you can't be here for the whole thing. Good.
I'm Angus Rocket. I'm a department head, so my task is to figure out how to get my faculty to teach ethics. And I've had the pleasure of knowing Michael since
the dinosaurs walked the earth. Yes.
And I don't think you'll find a better person on ethics training anywhere. So
well, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to have you move just once. We're going to have all the aces up at the first table here, the twos here, and threes, I guess, here, and fours over here. So this is the only time you have to move. You get to meet new people. You may notice that I've hand out cards in numerical order, so you have to sit next to somebody who you did not come in with. So I'm trying to demonstrate a teaching method just right here from the get-go, putting people into random groups. Threes. One, aces, twos, threes, and fours. Aces here.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you
want us
all sitting around one table?
Yeah, right now we'll be facing forward, but then eventually we'll get into a smaller group. For the second half, you'll be groups of four, but right now it's...
Oh, okay. I was confused because I thought we had one more person.
Nope, it's the four aces, four twos. It works out, right? Groups of four. Okay. Please get settled soon. So this method of doing instructional design called backward design, where you begin with the end in mind, as Stephen Covey once said. So we start at the end, and we'll start with learning goals. In order to remember, the theme is how to succeed without really trying. To know whether you've succeeded or not, you need to have goals in a way that you can define, so you can define what success means. Then assessments, which are ways to figure out whether you've achieved your goals or not. A lot of people think that ethics instruction is hard to assess, but by the end of today, you should know several methods for assessment. So that's one of my goals for today. And then activities as assignments to help students achieve these goals. And so this is the without really trying. We'll show you some different active learning activities that you can try tomorrow or next week or next semester in your classrooms, and these transfer. Okay, so let's start with some learning goals. So some typical learning goals can be even at the basic level. You're all teaching courses at many different levels, and so some of you teaching first year students where you might be aiming at some really basic levels of knowledge and understanding. For example, the American Chemical Society's ethical guidelines for publication, just a simple fact. They may not know what are in the guidelines, but at least they know that simple fact. Or engineers are responsible for safety, some basic things that what a code of ethics might say. You might ask as your goals something a little more demanding in terms of understanding, being able to explain why engineering is a profession, for example, or distinguish between what's legal and ethical in terms of obligations. Or maybe even identify a conflict of interest situation. If you were here yesterday, we had a conflict of interest situation, and I found when I give that same scenario to first year students, they don't perceive the conflict of interest because that requires being able to see things from other people's point of view. And developmentally, from a sort of education point of view, that's the main task of late adolescence, is learning other people's perspectives. So this is, we can use ethics instruction and learning about conflicts of interest to push them along the way of learning to take other perspectives in mind. Or if you have more advanced students or more time, you might be able to achieve a more advanced level of learning goals like the analysis, synthesis, or valuation level. So being able to weigh the relative importance of ethical values, say individual privacy versus community security. Somebody's teaching computer security here, so that's this is a central issue in a lot of our thinking about individual privacy versus the security of the public. Weighing those and which value is more important in which situation. Then designing a more synthesis kind of outcome, being able to design potential actions to honor all ethical obligations. This is entirely analogous to engineering design. Many of you teach engineering. There's a way of teaching ethics that approaches ethics as design, where there are many, many goals and constraints. They're often conflicting, but you try to satisfy as many constraints as possible. Here we're talking about ethical obligations, and think of ethics as design where there are many solutions, many good solutions, many bad solutions, but this is one way of approaching ethics as well. And then evaluating ethics actions. How good are these actions by, for example, applying a code of ethics? This is something I've actually done. I'll give a scenario related to computer ethics, and then evaluating using the code of ethics to evaluate the actions. So here, this is appropriate for longer sessions when you have a full course or at least a few weeks. You might be able to get students to achieve these kinds of levels. As you write learning goals, you should be concrete, observable, and measurable. That is, what should students be able to demonstrate? So there are two handouts. One is copies of the slides, one is the more narrative handout. Everybody has both? Right, we just want to make sure everybody has both. So what students should be able to demonstrate, and this is this will enable you to assess what these goals are. We can, so something more specific than appreciate the importance of integrity. Well, I don't know how to assess appreciate. That's a little more difficult, especially for regular classroom instructors. Behaving honestly in the future is, of course, a great goal. I can't dispute that, but this is very hard to assess, right? So it's not something you can easily do in your own classroom. And we're not talking about your goals, which are to cover the required material or survive this week. So we're looking at what students should be able to do. So first activity is page one of the handout. I'd like you to be able to identify your learning goals individually for a few minutes. Let's see. I think we're doing okay on time. So take about 5 minutes and write. You can use either the handout or your computer or tablet. And just identify a couple of learning goals that you think are realistic for your students and your situation. And then there'll be some report out. This is individual. Let's be quiet. Yes. I know, but no, you will. Right now you're sitting, you're co-located. But you'll get to share in a minute. Take a couple minutes and share with people on your team there, or somebody sitting next to you, it's fine. If you just want to share with somebody sitting next to you, we'll make this a little shorter here. We'll make this only a couple of minutes.
Would you speak louder?
Oh, he said we could do partners.
Yeah, right.
Or we can do
all
partners.
Okay, no, that's fine too.
Either way.
Shall we partner? Did you write
it?
Okay. That's okay. I can show you. So I thought I was able to
identify ethics issues, data science engineering,
you share with, see what you got, either pair up or.
Yeah, I agree with that. I would argue that I would, that's one of our goals too, is to not separate the technical analysis from the ethical analysis.
Mm-hmm. How you can show that it really is interconnected. That, so a goal then is to, so students will be able to explain how the technical and ethical are linked together.
Exactly.
Okay, so you phrase it, it will be able to explain, mm-hmm. right? That's a verb that you can then, you hold them accountable for being able to explain how that, look for the verb, explain. Okay, what do we got here?
In the same way that they were doing the charts for their engineering design, we want.
You're going to hold on to that because I need to know who the arts person is.
Tools.
Yeah. Well. So hold on to your card because I'm going to call in a random person, and arts gets to report the first time.
So. The general survey with our freshmen. You know what makes it?
Yes.
We did that like.
Some one of these. This is group three. So somebody had three. That's fine. You'll need to hold on to that.
We already have an assignment understanding that based on these to design the actions and then evaluate those actions. We already have one. Be able to express the complexities of an engineering project.
Mm-hmm.
So, identify their stakeholders.
Identify, good.
Yep.
That's a nice idea.
Yep.
Concrete verb.
Lots of work on learning outcomes.
Yes.
Identify various stakeholders mm-hmm. who will be impacted by a design solution. This is very similar to your story. Communicate the ways in which an ethical dilemma may be solved
mm-hmm.
to honor various
concerns.
Identify diverse ethical perspective in case studies, and
mm-hmm.
the second one related to that is identify how diverse cultural resources can only be equal to value different ethics.
Mm-hmm.
And it's of course on intercultural
community. Right. Yeah.
But it aligns. I mean, all
mm-hmm.
three of
yes.
Right?
That's great.
Because it's well, but there's a whole bunch of engineers who are involved making different decisions. Some people know, and some people weren't aware of it. They were also client So I thought, but there's both. So there was both legal and ethical scenarios in that, and I liked the way that.
Okay, I'm going to call time here. So I'm going to call on a couple of people randomly to report out either one of their goals or a goal that they heard that was really good. So the Two of Hearts, who holds the Two of Hearts? Yes. So you have goals that are really good or ones that you heard that are really good?
Share John's
goal.
Yeah.
Can you speak up? So, actually, let me give you the microphone so we can be on tape too.
I can speak up.
Okay.
Can I put my teacher voice on? Okay. So, demonstrate how privilege, disadvantage, and discrimination are perpetuated today and develop alternative attitudes and actions to challenge and dismantle these systems of exclusion and oppression.
Okay, so demonstrate and develop. There's really a couple of different verbs there. So, mm-hmm. It's two goals really. But that's okay. So demonstrate, presumably you have some concrete way in mind that they either write something or they illustrate something, design something. Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. Who has the Three of Hearts?
Your
Okay, yes, please tell us what is what either you, one of your good goals or one a goal that you heard that was really good.
Well, quite honestly, we didn't get the preview of...
I know, you didn't hear all of them.
Yeah.
But you heard somebody's. And you know yours.
It was mine.
Fine.
And quite honestly, it was a little bit more influenced from our conversation
okay.
earlier. So one of those is understanding different viewpoints of the persons or entity involved in an ethical dilemma.
Okay.
And
so understanding different viewpoints. So
yes.
You teach first-year students.
First year,
so this is an important challenge for them.
Yeah.
And I think that is very appropriate for your context. John, I assume, teaches either more advanced students or honors students who are capable, in depending on the time that you have, to achieve perhaps a more advanced kind of outcome there. Great. So it's perfectly fine. You can have different kinds of goals for different situations. Does everybody get the idea about learning goals? I think I heard things that are concrete, observable, even measurable. We'll get to measurement and assessment. Actually, I think that's the next segment here. So very good. Report out. We just did that. So again, notice that I randomized the hearts card, so there were hearts people reporting out. Just to demonstrate some different teaching techniques as we go along here. And I love cold calling, but it's calling on random people who've had a chance to hear other people first. So the next quarter, is on assessment here. Assessment is the way of where we gather and analyze data about how well students are progressing in achieving the learning goals that we set out for them. So there are two kinds of assessment. It comes in two flavors. When the purpose of assessment is improvement, we call it formative assessment. And when the purpose is accountability, we call it summative. So a course grade, for example, is generally summative. It says it's the accountability, it's the final word on how well the student has done. Final exam is a purely summative kind of assessment because at that point there's no really chance to improve. So there's actually a whole spectrum of assessments here. Homework, we'll explain what CATs are in a moment, but homework is primarily for improvement. It's as students are learning the topic, they get some feedback about how well they're doing. Quizzes are sort of in the middle. Exams are primarily for grade. Usually you count the exams pretty significant part of a student's grade, but there's also for learning as well. And then the final exam is primarily summative, and it's really hard for the student to improve after that point if it's the final exam. And it's really at that end of assessment. Now, what are CATs here besides small furry mammals here? CATs stands for classroom assessment techniques, which are entirely way at the formative end. They're entirely for learning and improvement. So I understand that many people have never heard of CATs before, and so this is one of those very useful techniques that you can use whatever you're teaching. Classroom techniques, assessment techniques, have used CATs before? So a few of you, okay? So let's take a look at some CATs here. The classic, the CATs are very quick. They can be done with a small amount of time in the classroom. They're generally ungraded, or if you grade them, it's just completion grading, which is, I think, better than attendance. So I just counted. You know, I come from computer engineering, so everything's 0 or 1. You were there or not. So yes, it was present or absent. So the classic first computer classroom assessment technique was the minute paper, which actually takes a little bit more than a minute. What was the most important thing you learned about during this class or about X today? And then what question remains unanswered? And it really takes 2 minutes. And if students are slow writers, more like 2 or 3 minutes. But that is kind of the classic CAT. And the other classic CAT is the muddiest point CAT, which is what was the most confusing point of the text or lecture or video or class session? They can be used. These are used in any subject and not just ethics. But as Pat Hutchings says, CATs yield a wealth of information for a minuscule investment of time. This gives you lots of feedback to yourself as an instructor about how the class as a whole is doing. And you can see just how students are doing with small pieces toward learning goals. So let's give some examples from ethics and ones that I have actually used. So the one sentence summary. In one long sentence of about 50 words, define engineering professional responsibility. Address who, what, and why. And I say, you may use semicolons, so you could just keep extending the sentence on and on and on. And then I write my own, but as I listen and I see what students are thinking, this gives me an idea of just how deep or sophisticated their understanding of engineering professional responsibility is. And this connects directly with the learning goal of being able to define professional responsibility. It hits it right there on the head. You could also make it a quiz question as well. Okay? So I've also used the student-generated questions, write a question that could appear on an exam on today's topic. This is a little more general. It requires being able to understand the topic in enough depth to develop a sensible question. Actually, this is how I get all my test questions. I ask students to generate them and choose the best ones. Actually, not all my test questions, but this can be useful. Another is directed paraphrasing. In plain language and in less than 5 minutes, paraphrase what you heard in this lecture about information privacy for the vice president of a large insurance firm who is ultimately responsible for database security. Your aim is to convince her to spend time and money to upgrade the security software. So this is a longer cat. It takes longer. They have to write a very short essay, sort of like micro themes, if you will. But this is directed toward a particular goal. It's a kind of an applied question and thinking about the audience. So this has the advantage of where the student has to use what they've just learned in an applied situation. So this might support your goal of being able to, where students will be able to apply what they've learned to explain the importance of certain values to lay people, for example. That might be a goal that you have. And then defining features matrix. Let's see, where is this? So. Is it a gift? Is it a tip? Is it a bribe? Is it a grief payment? Well, what are the different kind of features of these different kinds of actions? And often what we want to do is to help students understand the distinctions among different kinds of concepts. Bribes and grief payments there's a lot of concern about, say, corruption. There's actually something in the IEEE Code of Ethics that addresses this that seems to be very important to the IEEE. But then you can look at features like when is it given? Well, a bribe or grief payment or a bribe or grief payment is given in advance of something, whereas a tip is usually given after the recipient has done something, and the size, the purpose. And so these can help you make distinctions about the morally significant features of a bribe versus grief payments, for example. So the bribe is to influence somebody to do something they would not normally do, whereas a grief payment is the purpose to influence them to do something they really ought to do. So maybe is less morally objectionable. Let's see. So that's another one. And then the background knowledge probe is like a short quiz, I'd say, at the beginning, assessing students' baseline knowledge. Here you want to know what do they come in with. So the concept is Kansas City Hyatt walkway collapse. Have never heard of this. Maybe heard of it, but don't really know what it means. Have some idea of what this means, but I'm not too sure. Or I have a clear idea of what this means and can explain it and why it's important to know about. Or similarly with a concept like conflict of interest, have never heard of the concept. Have heard of it, but don't really know what it is. Have some idea what it is, but not too sure. Or have a clear idea of what it is and can explain. So notice that these are all also activities. And the next phase of this workshop will consider activities that you can use to teach ethics. But these are even short activities that can be integrated very quickly and are connected with your learning goals and give you, the instructor, if you collect these answers, some information about how the students are doing relative to your learning goals. So we now have another short activity, which is create one or more cats for your ethics session. And we have, again, individual working time, and then time to share and report out. So we're doing individual working time for about 5 minutes. Michael. Yes.
I need to leave it. I'm teaching through.
Okay, just leave. It's okay. Good. Well, you have the notes. You can see what else you're missing. But you won't be able to see the videos I have right at like 3:05. There's these great videos. Yeah. Well, the URL's on the sheet, in the slides.
Thank you for the resource.
Yeah. There are two URLs. There are two videos, but the first one, it's a great video. I wish I could say that myself. So. Okay, I'm going to call time here, and so you can now share with people in your small group, get good ideas from your teammates here, group mates. Oh yeah, and feel free to get refreshments as we're working here. Shin, you can join this group and contribute ideas too.
Yeah,
come up and join us.
I have created a cat.
I'm sorry, you have what?
I have created a cat.
You have created cats.
Yep,
we're gonna before.
We did one last semester that was just a short variation on the question that you posed. So the one that we did last semester was, what is a good engineer?
Okay,
and
yeah, that's good.
Trying to get them to talk about what is the meaning of good.
Good, yeah, right, good.
And so then we're thinking this semester we could revisit it, since now they're working on an actual engineering design project, mm-hmm. to say, what are the professional responsibilities of a good engineer?
Ah, excellent. Right. Yes, so, that's good. So we're refining that.
Yeah, exactly. So it'll, they'll hopefully trigger their memory.
Yeah, I don't think they'll remember. No, it's especially you teach first year students.
We have them for the whole year. Though, I know, but so it's we know them but very the, well.
Well, it's just hard for first year students to connect things.
Yep.
It's everything
you're
is
so
like,
right.
And again, pushing them to try to connect a little bit, mm-hmm. and build those connections.
Yep.
That's about as far as you can get.
That's right. That's
but
right.
That's okay. That's part of the journey.
Yep.
And that's your job, is to keep pushing them.
Uh-huh.
Okay, you guys got some good cats here. So I like your cat.
We fictionalized what has happened with the engineer at BW.
Especially in that case, then people you're teaching them a counter.
Oh, I see your design is finding a problem.
Well, they have to better define them. So they're given so they have to discuss it with their clients.
So Bo, feel free to listen on the people here.
Yeah. Will do. Thanks.
Yeah.
So yes, they're given a problem, but they have to better define it in their own words, right? It's a client coming to them. Some of them might not be engineers.
Forever. One thing that I always wanted to see is like having the ethics come in the problem definition phase instead of the tag at the end. Students were like, oh yeah, they're great classes.
So it could be part of the considerations and so that they
before them. A never heard of B, never heard of a dog, all the way up to E, which is, I know what it is, and not only could I explain it, but I could identify its broader social significance. Of course, no one's going to pick that, because it's way too bold, but I would have been able to see that as a engineer. After our discussion and application with Jason, I
wanted to lose gain, and that's just the way of it.
Yeah.
The world is, we live in a world of
the experience and ethical dilemma that you encountered or were faced with, how did you resolve it?
Mm-hmm.
Or invent one if you don't want to talk about your own personal and a dilemma, describe it to a group of people and talk among the group about how you resolve it.
Mm-hmm. So that's a pretty big one, depending on you have very sophisticated students, I'm sure you could. That means like telling a whole story, right? Mm-hmm. You could do that. I mean, you'd have to give them enough time to be able to write something. It's almost like a homework assignment, though, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you could do that.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, that's good. It makes it real.
Driver's Ed, when they said, you know, come up with a difficult situation when driving a car.
Mm-hmm.
I remember in my driver's ed class, they said, okay, you know, give an example of a problem you might encounter on the road.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
So unfortunately,
yeah, I know you have to leave.
5 minutes.
Oh, okay.
So
I'm sorry. You got to go. But the URL is in the handout, so.
I know how to find you, Michael.
Yes. Oh, that too.
So I actually was for the name as well. So we're foundation.
So I'm going to call time and we'll have a little report out here.
Manage all of our ethics.
So let's see. Who has the Ace of Spades? Ace of Spades is down here somewhere. Somebody.
It might be me.
Okay.
I am. You got to pick one of those.
Okay. Yeah. Well, no, I'll pick a spades person. Sorry. I should have known that. Well, but who has a four of spades? Four of spades. So we're going to report out what you got into either your cat, a cat you like, or a cat you've heard of that's really good.
I think the Datic product raising cat.
So So for your particular situation, give me what your directed paraphrase cat would look like. You wrote one?
No.
You didn't design one. Did you hear one here that's really good? Yeah, hers.
It's a kind of a revision of a cat that we had done in the fall, where we asked the students, you know, what is a good engineer? And so like the meaning of good, so I thought that we could revise the cat to be, what are the professional responsibilities of a good engineer implementing this design that they're working on in Golden? So that they're aware of context and stakeholders.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so again, very simple, and something students can respond to in a few minutes, say 3-5 minutes or something like that, short essay, micro theme sometimes it's called, and then you can see just how broad their thinking is, since you've got first year students just pushing them that next step to think of multiple stakeholders, I think is already an achievement. Okay, let's see, I've got the three of spades here. Who has the three of spades? Yeah, so Cindy.
One is, I have a book called Robot Ethics, which has about 20 chapters, each of which covers, I think, very interesting topics. So we would have each student within the team pick a different chapter. And the idea is, as a computer scientist, you should be able to paraphrase that. You should be able to explain that to a lay audience, make it real, make it concrete. So you prepare for that. And then our advisor meetings, which happen weekly, you go around and there'll be 3 to 6 students, and each student will do their quick 5-minute paraphrase for the others, educating them and practicing that skill. And the second one was the one sentence summary of what makes a good engineer. I wanted to collect those anonymously, put them on a piece of paper, and I will give one group's summaries to another group, so there's nobody, no feelings will be hurt, and critique them.
Ah, excellent. So you make that as an activity. So
yes.
Partly it's the information of what are students thinking of, what is a good, in this case, computer engineer, software engineer. And then you have another short activity, which is having the students critique those. And then you don't have to do the grading, right? You just have the students critique. That's feedback already. Well, very good. So let's see. We're actually doing well on time here. I tried to. Since my background is electrical and computer engineering, you know, we're always precise to the microsecond here. Some people even do nanoseconds. So some of you, we talked about classroom assessments, which are primarily informal and they're formative. When you have homework, quiz, or exam problems, these can be graded systematically by using grading rubrics. When you design a grading rubric, you want to specify criteria that are based on your learning goals. What is it that you're looking for? And then different levels of performance for each criterion. And most of us can, human beings can distinguish, at least I found as an instructor, being able to describe 3 to 5 different performance levels. There is a decision procedure scoring guide on page 3 of your handout as an example of a rubric. And my thought question for you is whether you might be able to adapt this rubric for your own ethics instruction or do something similar. As part of I was going to have an internet treasure hunt, and one of the things I did is I put ethics assessment rubric, and out pops a rubric at Colorado School of Mines, right near the top of the search results. So. Somebody around here has already put together one, but again, for that particular purpose. But this is one of those just think, just a few minutes and think about, take a look at that and what you might want to do. There's no report out or doing anything with this at this point. I just want you to take a look at one. Thank you. You have a question, yes.
The selection of the word moral versus ethical.
Moral versus ethical. Correct. So we have a question here. The bottom left corner says morally significant. Some people make strong distinctions between moral and ethical. Moral is the more, I consider, and the way I define it is the more general term is what is good, what is right. Ethical has to do with specific moral standards that apply to particular groups of people like engineers, engineering ethics, standards that apply to doctors, medical ethics. Ethical also refers to a sub-branch of philosophy. But in sort of general everyday speech, they're more or less synonyms. So that's why many people get them confused. And most people, they're more or less synonyms. Okay. Other questions? That's interesting how these are stapled.
Yeah.
Unconventionally stapled. You know, why staple them to normal? Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'd like to go on now to the next phase. There's one more I want to say about a general assessment test. Some general ethics assessment tests have been developed as well. These have usually undergone some rigorous psychometric testing for validity and reliability. As you know, the educational psychologists who develop these tests are experts at the art of quantifying the unmeasurable. But these are reasonably reliable and valid. All the references are on the handout. The full references are sort of at the end of the handout. And I just want to mention there's the defining issues test is a very general test of moral reasoning. It's a test of how well your reasoning matches up with the Kohlberg model of moral reasoning, how sophisticated it is, whether you use abstract principles or not, or whether you're more conventional or whether you've been pre-conventional. So there's a particular theoretical background, and it's sort of a very general test, and it's been used in engineering. I don't know if it's been used in science classroom. The TESSE, the test of ethical sensitivity in science and engineering, these are all multiple choice tests. They don't have to be, but these happen to be multiple choice. So here the goal is just being able to be aware of or name a particular ethical issue. So naming a conflict of interest, being able to less sophisticated than reasoning. The engineering and science issues test is a test of reasoning. It's built on the same Kohlberg model as the defining issues test, but all the scenarios that it uses are from science and engineering situations. And then the engineering ethics reasoning instrument that Jinju was involved in developing has to do with especially a lot of issues that arise in engineering teams, student teams in particular. The ethical decision-making measure is primarily for research ethics. The scenarios are primarily, and there's a version for life sciences, a version for physical sciences, a version for engineering, there's a version for social sciences. But it's very rigorously developed. You could try some of these. They may not match up exactly with your particular instruction or goals, but you have some way of comparing your results against other situations and what other people have done. So these are, and you can write to the authors to get the copies. DIT too, there's a small charge per instrument, but I think the rest are free. Okay. So the next component, which will take us the rest of the time, is activities and assignments. Here I have some longer activities. The first thing that you want to get, want to do in any ethics, any kind of instruction, is get students' attention. There's no learning without students getting away from their laptops and being on Facebook or Zappos or Amazon and actually paying attention to what's going on. So this is a picture in engineering ethics. We have lots and lots of disasters. This is the picture of the Kansas City Hyatt after the walkway collapse in 1981 that killed 114 people and injured 216. So, and when we teach engineering ethics, we have all kinds of disasters like Bhopal and Challenger, Chernobyl, the Ford Pinto, Therac 25. And in science, there are things like cold fusion. In business, the Enron disaster. How about examples from your own disciplines? What are sort of the touchstone cases that really everybody in your field should know about? I didn't know what field. I would thought it would be mostly science and engineering here, but all disciplines are welcome. So touchstone cases that everybody should really know about. So.
There's the Morales incident.
I'm sorry, the what?
The Morales incident.
Incident and Morales?
Yeah.
That's a fictional case. I'm glad you like that one because I was, full disclosure, I was involved in developing the Incident and Morales video.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a...
Incident and Morales video? It's great video, if I may say so myself. Best in Galaxy, yeah. And then also the Henry's Daughters follow-up. And I can regale you with many tales of what went wrong in the developing these videos. But that's another story. So we'll talk. I'm sorry, what? I'm sorry,
VW,
the Volkswagen, with the falsifying the results of, no, yeah, the VWD is falsifying the results of the emissions test. Okay, so that, I don't know whether there are some case materials, but there are some accounts of what happened. I'm not sure we've gotten to the bottom of it yet, I think, but that's an ongoing case. And it has the advantage of being recent, and it captures students' attention, because this is real stuff. Any other cases that probably everybody should know about? Yeah.
Well, the GM ignition switch.
GM ignition switch, yes.
Summarized in PRISM a couple of years ago.
Yes,
an ethical case study.
Right, it is. So that's another good example. The story, of course, is very more complicated. There were some, but apparently there's been what they called the ignition switch from hell or something like that. The poor chief engineer in charge of that was just having a terrible time. Very good. I'm glad somebody likes Incident and Morales. That's good. You're probably the first person who told me that.
That's the only real video out there.
Oh, well, there's Henry's Daughters, the follow-up.
We haven't.
You haven't seen Henry's Daughters? You should see Henry's Daughters. So I think it's on my list of resources there, too. Okay.
I think a real example is Henrietta Lacks.
Henrietta Lacks. So definitely people who do human subjects. So the next thing I promise people is this video. So this is the lab, and this is great fun.
It was a bad day. It started with just one reporter.
Excuse me, Mr. Ross?
Yes?
Paul Williams, Channel 8 News.
Okay.
Mr. Ross, researchers from another university are questioning some of the recent high-profile findings from one of your labs. Do you have any...
I'm sorry, I can't. You'll have to direct these questions to our general counsel.
But Mr. Ross...
I'm sorry I haven't been here. A scientist from a competing lab decided to go public with suspicions that some very celebrated research from our university had been falsified.
The research that was hoped might lead to breakthroughs in the treatment of diabetes might not be all it first appeared to be. Paula Williams has the story.
We don't hear much about the world of test tubes and lab rats until there's a major breakthrough with major public health implications. Add federal dollars and accusations of fraud to the equation, and you have a potentially explosive story.
I was very interested in this paper. My lab's been doing very similar work.
But it blew up pretty quickly.
A preliminary assessment indicates there are grounds for moving forward and looking into all the research with which this individual is involved.
But?
We decided that further investigation is required to determine whether research misconduct has occurred.
It turned out badly.
9 months after allegations of research misconduct, a young scientist here who seemed to have a bright future ahead of him has finally admitted to falsifying his research.
The investigation turned up multiple instances of research misconduct by this individual over the course of a couple of years. Along the way, there were
people in the lab who had questions but didn't speak up. There were people who had responsibility for oversight who didn't properly exercise that responsibility. There were people who knew what was right and didn't do the right thing. And
is it true the McCrary family is withdrawing their commitment to establish a $30 million research endowment for your university?
Well, yes. As you know, they made that announcement today.
It just turned into the proverbial perfect storm.
After findings of professional misconduct and with mounting pressure of widespread bad publicity and more unhappy donors threatening to pull their funding, the principal investigator from this troubled lab who had been placed on probation has finally been dismissed.
The PI was let go, the lab was shut down, postdocs, grad students, lab techs, all scrambling to find a new place to continue their work, many while dealing with the stigma that comes from a tainted lab.
I love this because it captures your attention and it shows the kinds of bad consequences that can happen from simple thing like not reporting results accurately. It can have effects on many other stakeholders, right? So after you get students' attention, one way of teaching ethics, and I think the way you can teach without really trying, is with active and collaborative learning. So we're going to do some discussions of some short cases or scenarios, they're sometimes called. You could show a short video or movie. Actually, one of the cases that we'll have is a short video. Debate or structured controversy. The structured controversy is a form of debate where students have to switch sides two-thirds of the way through. So you're not locked into the position you're arguing for. And I think this is very good because in structured controversy, and you can look that up, it requires students to be able to see both sides of an issue and understand both sides rather than arguing just for their own side. And then role play I've used a lot, both short plays in the classroom, up to a two-week role play where students had to stay in character for 2 weeks. Yes. And it's pretty advanced, it's lots of fun. So there's an article about that, but that's pretty advanced and more risky because you don't know what's going to come out of students' mouths. There was one time I had a role play where the student, I think she's being pressured by her manager to go to the city council to get a variance because she knows somebody on the city council. So that the firm can construct on some wetlands or something. And she says, "You're my manager, not my pimp." This happens in the role play, and you would not normally hear that in an engineering classroom. So it was pretty fun. So are there other, we're gonna demonstrate a couple of these. Are other methods that you happen to like for teaching ethics? You're already in small groups. I do a lot of small group stuff. Any other favorite methods, classroom teaching methods? Did I cover them all? Probably a lot of you like to lecture too, but I like to lecture too, but you know, you can lecture for only so long.
But with the code of ethics, she would have them create a collaborative code of ethics.
Create a code of ethics. That's excellent.
Where they edit it over time.
Yes.
Right? Even mm-hmm. the whole semester. Or over
yeah. So that can be a longer term kind of assignment as well. Great. So we're going to do a short scenario on an issue. So since I didn't know what disciplines you would all come from, I chose something on ethics of teaching. And I believe this is in page 4 of the handout as well. Frank Fresh is 27 years old and well-liked by the students. He's become one of the most popular instructors on campus. 3 or 4 students are usually in his office, often talking about rock groups, sports, and other non-academic topics. Fresh can often be found around lunchtime at the crowded table in the Student Center food court. Some of Fresh's colleagues believe he's overstepping the boundary between faculty member and friend. Is there a problem? Why or why not? So, take 5 minutes and discuss that in your small groups, and I'm going to, again, call in random people to report out.
Yeah.
assuming they are, but is that he would have a hard time being objective.
But then if you say, especially
with leaders, right? If you use a rubric, there's leeway. These are not black and white lines. And so it's going to influence that. He, by his peers, I mean, if he's on a tenure track, by his peers,
he's already set up. If I have four kids who are always hanging around me, and one of them doesn't do well on an exam, does that set up an internal conflict for me?
Potentially.
I like that student. I want them to do well, which we all do with all our students.
So I think he's creating he or she. Oh, yes, it's having to create non-traditional. That's why we're thinking about it.
So do you think there's a problem?
Do you think there's a problem because you might have a conflict of interest in evaluating?
I think we have to look at what's possible for you. Could be a conflict of interest. How do other students who are not studying
relationship?
So, did you come in late?
I did.
Okay, well,
I did.
I'm glad you can just jump right in.
That's
in a group.
Right. Yeah.
Will it be? Yeah, one of the better
groups. And you're a professor who's not feeling buddy-buddy, it might set up expectations that cause friction within the department. I was just trying to think of all the problems I was using.
I have a very, very small university. And so faculty members eat every single day, every single lunch with students. And we only had one place to eat.
Because that's the norm for the whole
And that's the norm for the whole country.
And we're really have dinner at houses.
You know, it was not everybody. You know,
that everybody was open. It could be invited or included to it.
No, no, you know, certainly like just the ones who were in this particular group or this particular section.
But it didn't cause any problems within that.
So it's just I think it's called, you know, as Chinna is saying, culture is, there's something about campus cultures, right? Where some campuses have more of a culture about this and other campuses
that's a great
place
do
not.
Many of these programs probably have.
Oh, yeah, also within, within the same context, campus, yes.
Yeah.
The managed departments.
Like the McBride, the owners.
So there could be a potential
One on the Senate Evaluation Committee right now is we're talking about the student test says your availability or your
So I don't know. I don't as long as he can differentiate between now he's going to have.
Well, and the perception. It's like a professor that has office hours.
If
someone told you that, you're your reaction.
But not if it's a senior faculty. The 27-year-old public background. But if you have a senior faculty, and this has been their style, and everyone respects that.
Okay, we're going to call time here, and I'm going to call into this time on the people. Who has the four diamonds? You do. Yeah. Pass it to somebody on your team there. So, Chin?
Yes.
So, let's hear what Chin has to say, his team has to say about this.
So, we talked about some of the potential ethical issues in this scenario. So, first of all, I said, because I'm from a totally different cultural background.
I can see an ethical issue in this scenario, then my colleagues understand the American culture. So might be some of the issues with as discussing in the scenario, the boundary between faculty member and friend, some potential problems here. Oh, we also talk about.
So what is the name? I mean, you say a problem. Isn't there, ethics is not only what's bad, but what's good, right? Is there anything?
Right.
Did you look at what's good or what's bad or both? Or?
We did. We talked about relationship building. Mm-hmm. The importance of groups.
Yeah. You want to establish rapport with the students. Know where the students are coming from.
Exactly.
You can teach better if you know their backgrounds, right? That's why the first thing I did is find out a little bit about where you're coming from, what your interests are. Same thing, okay? So there's something good, and then you said, but there could be a problem.
Yeah, it could be something like a problematic professional relationship.
Beginning of unprofessional relationships.
Or the faculty member, because you know he spends too much time with the students in his office talking about unprofessional issues might actually affect other faculty members.
Oh, really?
I don't know.
How could it affect other faculty members? I don't understand.
Too loud.
Oh, I see.
Make
other faculty members look bad?
Less productive.
So, I see. Okay, so, but there are trade-offs here. There's pluses and minuses. Is there anything else you wanted to add? I'll call in another group here. No? Okay, who has the Two of Diamonds? Yeah, so tell me, what did your team think?
So one opinion is that so basically, like John and also myself, we feel so far it seems we cannot identify any very clear clue about ethical issues.
Ah, right. So it's hard to perceive whether there's an ethical issue here. So we're going to talk about the ways in which you can perceive the ethical issues here. Okay.
But could potentially, I'm not quite sure. There could be some of the issues in the future.
Right, could be in the future, such as?
Maybe some of the topics may not be that appropriate.
Okay, some topics may not be appropriate. Yeah. I heard one group talk about a conflict of interest or bias in grading.
Yeah.
Ah,
yeah.
So tell me more. What did your team say?
We were discussing that as you become friends or friendlier with your students, it becomes difficult to be objective.
There's no such thing as objectivity.
I mean, it's and even in using rubrics,
yes,
they're not black and white.
Mm-hmm.
You could, it's difficult when you have to critique someone that you are friendly with.
Right. So this actually gets to the one of the key issues here is, and this really is part of the relationship. Professors are expected to have professional relationships with students. As professionals, they are expected to exercise professional judgment in assessing the quality of the student's work, even applying a rubric. That still requires judgment. It's not turn the crank. It's not professional work. It's work that can't be automated easily. So this could impair the ability of the instructor as a professional to exercise that judgment because of the relationship. And we call this a conflict of interest situation. So why is conflict of interest a problem? I mean, we all we all have relationships with people all the time. I write recommendation letters for colleagues who are friends. And so why is conflict of interest a problem? Yeah, what do you think, Cindy?
It might not be fair to other students.
Favoritism, right. It may not be fair to other students. And even worse than that, there's a perception of favoritism. So that's the problem with conflict of interest, is that your judgment may not be impaired. You may still make very good judgments, but it's that there's a perception of favoritism, the perception of bias, and so that means your judgment is less reliable, fewer people can trust your judgment, and since clients, students have to rely on the professional's judgment, it's important that judgment be trustworthy. So the problem with conflict of interest is not so much the relationship of whether you will make a bad judgment, but that it be less trustworthy. So as Michael Davis, I keep quoting Michael Davis because he is really the best person in the field in this. He says conflict of interest is like dirt in a pressure gauge. Doesn't mean the reading will be incorrect, but that it will be unreliable. And we need to be trustworthy, but professionals have a special duty for trustworthiness because clients are sort of need to be able to trust the judgment of the professional. So we ask, well, how do you perceive the ethical issues here? So that's next. I have a little, sort of mini lecture, and then we'll have a chance to apply what you learned here. So how can we approach these ethical problems and be able to perceive and then evaluate different aspects of ethics? And this is, some people are looking for practical ways of doing this. I teach students this sort of very simple way of approaching ethics problems or cases. It's on page 4. And this is how to avoid a lot of moral theory. So when I teach ethics and engineering, I never mention Kant. I never mention Aristotle or Hume or Rawls. We apply sort of an engineering process, an analysis problem, a process. So similar to the sort of problem-solving skills that you engage in as an engineer. Identify the affected parties, analyze their rights and responsibilities, determine whether additional information is needed to make a wise decision. This requires literally the ability to see what is not there without hallucinating. So asking the question, is there some additional information that might be help us make a good decision here? Consider alternative actions by the main actors. What are the opportunities for action here? That's a synthesis or design step. And then how we evaluate these actions, often we imagine possible consequences. We talked about Frank Fresh. What are the possible consequences in the future if he has to exercise professional judgment in grading students' work? What might happen? And then evaluate those alternatives by looking at these possible consequences. It's not an automatic procedure. It's not an algorithm that you can simply follow, but it helps you sort out different ethical concerns. And then evaluating these actions and consequences, you can use basic ethical values like honesty, civility, kindness, and so on. The Daniels Fund Ethics Initiative has principles. This is a nice set of values that there are many models of values, but this one is very nice and pretty comprehensive. Integrity, trust, accountability, transparency, fairness, respect, rule of law, and viability, and these are definitions within the Daniels Fund. So this is like integrity and transparency are aspects of honesty, and so I think that this is one model of values that might be helpful for you. Or you can use some basic tests. Many students will understand a harms test, which is like a cost-benefit test. Do the benefits outweigh the harms, short-term and long-term? So consider both short-term and long-term consequences. Suppose I'm writing a lab report and I throw out the anomalous data. I can make my results look good and finish the lab report right now. So that's a good consequence, but it's a short-term consequence. What happens to my long-term reputation for integrity? Okay, so thinking about, it's like cost and benefits. Very natural for engineering students to think about that. Or most people, reversibility test. Would this choice still look good if I traded places? Very useful to imagine the perspective of other people. Like Myrna wants students to understand that there are other perspectives here. If you're reading my lab report and you know I falsified the data, can you trust the report? Right? How does this look from the viewpoint of other people? In fact, Dwight Eisenhower, when he was president, used to ask, how does it look to the other guy? The common practice test. What if everybody in a similar situation chose the same action? What if everybody who falsified lab data? Then nobody would be able to trust any lab results. So this is sort of the everyday version of Kant's categorical imperative or universalizability test. You don't have to mention that. Just say, what if everybody behaved this way? What if it were common practice? Right? You're not special. You may think you're special. Right? The big blue dinosaur says, you're a very special person. No, you're not special. Okay. Legality test. Now, you know, would this choice violate a law or policy of my employer? Laws are relevant, but as we know, it's not exactly the same as what's ethical. So there's a difference between what's ethical and what's legal. Suppose you're driving on a busy highway in a big city. If you drive safely with the flow of traffic, you're exceeding the speed limit and breaking the law. But if you drive at the speed limit, other motorists are trying to pass you, and you're endangering other motorists. So, another example is laws can't possibly cover every possible activity. When the Enron executives claimed that they had done nothing wrong, what they meant is they had done nothing illegal. What they did was allowed by law. But even if allowed by law, their actions were clearly deceptive and fraudulent. So there's a difference there. And also, laws generally tell us what we should not do, but ethics is what we should do. So there's some differences, but we should still honor the laws because they're generally the consensus of society or the profession. Colleagues test. What would professional colleagues say? And so this will, often that's expressed in codes of ethics. Another test, wise relative test. What would my wise old uncle or aunt do, right? Who's a revered person around here? I don't know, Carl Mitchum or something. What would Carl do? Just looking for a senior person. What would Barbara Moskal do? Is somebody I know, I've known. What would John Lydens do? He's been here for a long time. I can embarrass him now because he's not here. What would John do in this situation? Mirror test. Would I feel proud of myself if I looked into the mirror afterwards? And then my favorite is the publicity test. How would this choice look on the front page of the student newspaper? Everything I know is from reading the student newspaper, right? You too? So that's where you get all your news, the student newspaper? Right? There must be one here at Mines, right? Okay. So these are some ways of which we can talk about the morality of action. Not all tests are applicable in all cases. The reversibility test is particularly good for Frank Fresh's case. You look at it from the viewpoint of other students. All these colleagues, in terms of professional colleagues, so the sense of professionalism here. And probably John would tell you that this is probably, you don't want to go too far, right, in being too friendly with students. You want to be friendly but not friends. So that's an important distinction. Okay, we have time for looking at yet another video. And we'll get a chance to discuss that. So this is a video that happens to be about research ethics. And I think, again, it's sort of discipline applies to all disciplines. So.
Just call me when you finish and we'll meet in my office. Sorry.
Oops. We'll just keep going here.
So where were we?
You were just telling me how the review of Compton's article is going.
Oh, it's okay. I just wish I got on top of it right away. I'm getting close to my deadline.
Sometimes that's the only way to really get motivated.
I haven't been procrastinating. I've just been swamped. And there's always something. That search committee is eating an amazing amount of time.
Well, I'll look it up before you send it if you like. I've done enough work for them now that I kind of know what they're looking for.
That would be great. I've only got this week to write it. I could have it to you by Thursday. I still need to research the Forsberger heart scale. I'm not really familiar with it, but it's one of the tools they use to test the response.
Forsberger heart?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's unbelievably complex.
You're kidding. Wait, do you know it? Could you help me out?
I would if I could. All I know is that it's pretty esoteric. I've never had to deal with it. Maybe Morgan would know.
I'm not Morgan. I need him to think I'm on top of my game.
Feeding the tenure beast.
Naturally. Okay, do you think of anyone who'd give me a Cliff's Notes rundown? I probably shouldn't have agreed to do the review, but I've been bugging them about giving me a chance. Should I call and fess up?
Only if you don't care that you'll never get another review. Can you write around it? Talk about everything else in detail and not mention that analysis.
That's a thought. I'll figure it out.
He'll be all right. Maybe you could send it back for a revision to buy a little time.
Oh, no. Not after Stan got reprimanded for conflict of interest stalling publication of that article.
That's a little different. He sent it back 3 or 4 times.
I heard 4, saying it was incoherent, questioning the data analysis.
He was intentionally stalling a breakthrough article because he was working on competing technology and didn't disclose it. How blatant is that?
That's major. It's from the journal. They want me to review a second article.
Way to go. You haven't even got the first one yet.
Since you're already evaluating an article using the Forsberger Heart Scale, we'd like to take advantage of your expertise once again and have you provide a review for an article in which it is the primary classification instrument.
Uh-oh.
It seems now I'm an expert in Forsberger Heart. Why didn't I decline and admit it was out of my realm of expertise?
I think that's it.
Yikes.
Okay. So now you have a chance to discuss these in small groups. What are the ethical issues? Is there any information missing? Alternative courses of action? And possibly benefits and harms of each? Simple way to think about this.
So do you find some bits that the business examples got more different from the engineering?
No.
That's interesting. Just not on the topic, but
yeah.
And this information that's going to get published, it's supposed to be peer reviewed.
Right.
It's not being peer reviewed if it's got some of the,
right.
Like
so the whole
expertise.
Notion of the institution.
So it diminishes this idea of peer review authority as well.
Especially since it sounds like it's
in
the
and tries to review. I liked her first, which was my
I'm
not sure on this.
Of course,
I'm
not sure. Well, and it allows if they could arc themselves.
It is. Well, the benefits may be that she does the right thing and contacts the journal and says, this really is outside of my expertise. There's a lesson there. I don't know
if she could review the first one and just
do it.
What is being reviewed, and if it gets out there to say this is a good model or this is safe,
and didn't want to look like she didn't understand.
Exactly.
There's something going on there.
That's part of why she probably is missing as well.
The background information about her is like I would like to know what the Forsberger Heart State is.
I think it's completely made up.
Yeah.
This is obviously fictional.
They did a really good job of using the lingo without actually talking about a specific discipline. That was pretty great.
Mm-hmm.
Very well done.
Yes. It's a very nice set of research ethics videos for those who teach science. Or, and usually you don't get to peer review for beginning students. So sure, this crowd, they understand peer review, right?
Right, right. Yeah, this would definitely be above.
Oh, yeah, right, right. But I thought it would be good for this group.
Yeah, definitely. You know? Great.
Sometimes a reviewer might even say something in the reviews, you know, like,
I mean, she may or may not. So,
and because she didn't push back and say, actually, I don't know this method, they're assuming that not declining means she's got this
feeling. Yeah, because the journal might have had time now to find somebody else to do the review if she's 1 week away. Right. So, her actions, her lack of coming forward is probably if nothing else, the which is probably minor compared to
that's true.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. But this sounds like it's much more, requires a lot more expertise. And is the expertise really outside of what she could understand, or is it just
Yeah. Is this a time constraint?
Or is it just lack of total background?
Because, you know, maybe there was a little bit of confidence in herself, that, you know, in the periphery, she understood what was going on. But then as soon as they say, oh, this is the tool that you're going to be using, okay, well, wait a minute.
As a gender thing, women tend to back away from those sorts of things more than men. We're encouraged to not back away because we may find men that are going to come back to bite her.
There might be a short-term benefit.
Ooh.
We're
losing people here.
I know.
Well, that's okay. Look, everybody's busy. They have. No, I never take things personally. I was an administrator for 4 years. I stopped taking things personally. Yeah, learn how to say no, and no, it's not personal, it's just business.
And I also have to leave 5 minutes, otherwise...
Oh, completely, I understand. Yeah, of course. No, that's
all right. It is me, isn't it?
Oh, really?
What?
No,
oh, I see, it's just leaving you. Okay, very good. So, maybe I should just call in a... Okay, so let's. I'm going to call time because we're disintegrating here. let me just call in one clubs person, and notice that I made it through all four suits here. Let's see, who has the ace of clubs here? Yes.
We do.
We do, yes, we, the team. The ace team, what's your evaluation of this scenario?
We liked her colleague's guidance.
Which is?
Number one, don't accept the second article.
Okay. What reason would you give?
She's not an expert. She
being candid about the... Well, that's good. Okay.
She's not in a position to evaluate it. Plus, she's just digging it deeper.
So there are a couple things going on here. This is being honesty and, in fact, candor as a very high form of honesty, and also an issue of competence, because professional competence is an ethical issue in all codes of ethics and professional codes of ethics. So that's observe. This is honoring those values. Okay, continue.
So, and then going back to the first paper she has to review, she could review around the instrument.
Mm-hmm.
And I like what Lauren recommended, which was maybe there could be pushback to say, this is an extremely difficult tool to understand. Mm-hmm. There could be more review or introduction of this tool in the article to guide your readers.
Right. So that's a practical... solution that's not obvious here. I like that because it's okay, you're giving credit, which is collegial and candid. Yes, collegiality is an important value too. Right, we respect other people, but with this high form of collegiality as a form of respect. But and so that would have the benefit of explaining this scale to readers, since presumably this journal is going to readers like the woman there. Who would be interested in this. So yes, that could be a concrete recommendation. Good. Anything else? This is great. This is the best I've heard on this scenario before.
Oh, yay.
Yeah. So informing the editor, you know, disclosing your limitations, commenting on the parts of which you are an expert, and often the missing information is why she was chosen as a reviewer in the first place. And as a journal editor and a former associate editor of various other journals, we'll choose some methodology experts, some content experts, and so on. So people might be chosen for different reasons anyway, and there might be still some value in her review. I know we're running short of time here, so I just want to go on. There's a couple of other things I want to mention in terms of homework assignments. So you could assign these short cases and ask students to evaluate them doing this kind of process, or maybe apply a code of ethics, or compare two codes of ethics. I've done that. Create a case or dialogue that dramatizes ethical issues. Creating Incident in Morales took $250,000 of your federal tax dollars, plus some donations. So it can be expensive, but we're not talking about that level of, you know, professionally produced video. And actually, your idea of creating a code of ethics, it was such a good idea, I even had it on my slides here. And I've done that. Other favorite assignments? So sort of take-home assignments that you would give? So when you have time in your class, depending on how much time in your class, that these are some typical things you can do encourage students, deepen students' understanding of ethics in your particular discipline or field.
I have one more that I'll add.
Yes.
The reflection one, mm-hmm. Question, reversibility test, the Rogerian rhetoric idea of having people write from the perspective of the other.
Ah, excellent idea. So
they read something from mm-hmm. the perspective. When they're doing their research, I have them pick the one that they're the most against or the one they can't grapple with, that, you know, mm-hmm. the most difficult for them to accept, and then try to write as though that's an acceptable one.
Right, from someone else's perspective.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. a challenge, but then they mm-hmm. are glad they did it. So.
Excellent idea. Okay. I was going to have an internet treasure hunt. And these websites are also in the resources list that I have there. But since we're running short of time, I want to make sure I can sum up and then have a few questions. But there are vast treasure troves of resources online. The Online Ethics Center at the National Academy of Engineering has resources for all of science and engineering. ResearchEthics.net is intended for people teaching research ethics for the first time. There are case materials, there's instructional notes, there's some. Just last night, somebody asked me, I saw an article about role plays in teaching responsible conduct of research. And in fact, they're all available for free at OnlineEthicsCenter.org, or OnlineEthics.org at the National Academy of Engineering, your federal tax dollars, to support this online resource. And again, full disclosure, I'm on the joint advisory group for the Online Ethics Center. So just to sum up, so we have a bit of time for questions. State explicit learning goals, so you know whether you're going to be successful or not. Select formative and summative assessments to determine whether, check to see whether students have achieved those goals and how well they've done. Use grading rubrics to evaluate students' progress toward the learning goals, and apply active and collaborative learning strategies in the classroom. So the rubrics are aligned with your goals, and the active and collaborative learning strategies enable you to succeed without really trying, because the students are doing all the hard work. So notice how we did that here. I just wanted to see how I typically make ad hoc random groups and then call in random people as well. And then there are lots of cases and resources online. So that's the workshop. And we have a few minutes for questions. And I think you have to get to a graduate council meeting. So having been a graduate dean, I know that it's important that people serve on graduate council. So you know, feel free to leave if you need to and take some food with you. Other questions or concerns that people have?
First, thank you for a really good workshop.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Yes, Chin.
These test questions.
Michael Davis is the handy ethics test questions, right?
Right.
Mine are adapted from his. They're shorter and yeah. but they're inspired by Davis.
So have you or anybody else, other scholars, compared like teaching effectiveness by using these
tests, right?
And like ethical theories, let's
say. Ah, yes, good question. So have I compared the effectiveness of teaching ethics using these simple tests
right.
versus applying ethical theories? No, I have not, and that's an excellent research project.
Okay.
I encourage you to do that.
Okay.
You're generating great research questions.
Okay.
Other questions that people have?
Sponsors the ResearchEthics.net.
ResearchEthics.net is produced by your friends at the University of California, San Diego.
Okay.
They're top people in research ethics, okay. Kalichman and Plemons. They're very good people.
Thank you.
That's why I can recommend them highly. Anything else? Okay, thank you. I know you got to go. Go, just go. Okay, thanks a lot for coming. Yeah.
Microphone.
Yes. Here we go.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll take all the cards back too.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming.
Okay. Okay, probably. Okay.
Thanks for the support, baby.